topic of attribution is one, you guys even touched upon it earlier this morning, so it's definitely a hot topic. But I also really want to talk about how this impacts organizations from a digital transformation perspective. Because it's not just enough to say that you're doing attribution. You have to have your organization really structured well in terms of how do you democratize data? How do you break down those silos within your own organization? So let's kick this off. I love to start with this quote because I think this is very much about where we are today. 40% of all businesses will die in the next 10 years. That's a reality, and we see it constantly. I mean, constantly. Some of my favorite brands, Toys R Us. That was a blow. That was like my childhood friend. That was a blow. Brookstone. I mean, come on. These are time-honored companies, the K-marts of the world. How many times are you out there now and you're seeing store closing signs for brands that you never thought would ever vanish? Your parents love these brands. You love these brands. Now they're gone. Your children will never know these brands. And a lot of this has to do with companies that are not embracing digital transformation. And most importantly, they don't know who their customers are. They don't know how to reach their customers effectively. So they're spending, yes, on television, on online, on print, and all these things. But they don't know if it really works. It's not really converting, and they don't have a handle on it. And the technology has become so much more sophisticated and advanced that they're basically lost. So you have to say farewell to them. And as I said, it was hard when I saw Jeffrey walk away with that suitcase. It's hard because this isn't just about brands. This is also affecting our economy and how we're thinking about things. And if you think about what a company, I'm based in Seattle, what Amazon has done has been all about embracing that digital transformation, understanding that data. Because if you understand that data on your customers, you're much, much better at acquiring them and retaining them. And that's what they've done incredibly well. And many of the brands we love, and there's some that are preparing to be on the chopping block, are struggling. I can name about 100 of them right now. They're struggling. And we talk to them all the time, but they can't quite figure it out. And that's where I'm sure many of you in this audience come into play, is how do they get a handle on it? And the topics of attribution and incrementality are really core to that, but it's also a much, much larger conversation. Now, there's fierce competition for customers. We all know that. And we know that the evolution of attribution can't just be last click. You've got to move to multi-touch. You've got to think about new paradigms of how you're attributing your media spend. We're talking about everything from all of the new digital touch points. I mean, how many of you work with clients who are all over social media and they're struggling to measure the impact of it? People who are doing influencer marketing, celebrity-based marketing, sports marketing, everything. But no one has great measurement capabilities behind it, nor have they thought about it. They all want to be there because that's the place to be, but they didn't actually put measurement plans in place in order to really track what they're doing. That's the core fundamental mistake. And I fundamentally believe what you can't measure, you can't manage. And that's important for all brands today. Because for every dollar that you spend acquiring a customer, if you're not really able to show that impact as a CMO, you won't be the CMO for very long. Those jobs come and go really, really fast. The other part of this is consumers have higher demands. Consumers are definitely much more digitally inclined now than they have ever been. And the expectations are very high. Everyone wants everything instantly. I want my brand to respond instantly so I can beat them up on Twitter, talk about them on Instagram, and I want that package shipped overnight. That is the customer expectation. So for brands who aren't up to that level, who don't have, you know, mobile optimized pages on their websites, who don't have a great cart flow, brands who don't do well in search, guess what? They're on the chopping block because there are too many other brands who've taken their place. How many of you have bought a product off Instagram? Raise your hand. How was that shopping experience? Just someone tell me.
Perfect.
Have you ever bought a product from another brand, not on Instagram, and it wasn't so perfect? All the time. And often the brands on Instagram you've never heard of. I mean, I buy stuff on Instagram all the time, and I'm like, who are these people? But it comes comes right away, as promised and advertised, and I'm like, wow, that was really cool. Just a couple of clicks, boom, I got what I want. That's my expectation. That's my expectation of every brand that I engage with. And that's the expectation of all consumers. And because right now our population is millennially driven, that is the norm. That is the expectation. The standards are high. The stakes are high. So when you think about what those digital capabilities are and what those tech partners are, the stakes are high. Choose very carefully. I'm happy to say we chose Google. And I love leading the Google Marketing Platform Alliance, because when it comes to technology and capabilities, I think they're pretty good. I don't have any complaints. But that is an important conversation that all companies have to have. Who is my technology partner? Are they thinking about what comes next? It's not good enough to just be good today. You've got to be good tomorrow, the day after, the year after. You have to constantly be innovating. And a part of that equation for brands and marketers is understanding, where is that consumer going? What are all of the influences that consumer's under? And how am I as a brand going to control that brand experience, maximize it, optimize it, and ultimately be able to tweak it so I can drive my company's profitability? Now, we all know digital ad spends growing. You've seen these slides a million times. But what's interesting about this is the pressure that digital is under is intense. Television isn't under as much pressure in terms of proving out that ROI the way that digital is. And I think now we talk a lot about, you know, having the right talent, people who understand programmatic, people who understand digital marketing. This is going to become even more and more key. But it's also a great opportunity for all of you in the audience, because you're rare. You're rare birds. When we're out there looking for talent that understands this space, it is hard to find. So imagine, I'm a brand spending $1 billion in this industry. I want top talent on my roster who know how to ensure that I'm maximizing every dollar that I'm spending. That yes, in fact, that every dollar I spend is going to ultimately get me not one customer, not two customers, but several customers. That's really the key. So as digital spend continues to grow, and this is not just in the US, this is global, because it is no longer acceptable to just be US-centric. The borders and the geographies have all been broken down. When I buy products, God only knows where they come from. China, Taiwan, Czechoslovakia, it doesn't matter, as long as I get what I want. As a marketer, you cannot just think about your local market. You have to think about there's a massive global market. And that's really the beauty of what the internet has done for all of us. It has given us amazing jobs that allow us to fly to Poland and Germany and all these other places. But it's about understanding where all of your customers are and what's going to appeal to those customers. So as that spend continues to increase, the pressure and scrutiny of how those media dollars are spent and how we're really attributing the value of those spends becomes even more critical. Now, companies are prioritizing attribution. No kidding. Of course they are, because they're all terrified. And I say that lightly, because it's really just about they're getting smarter. All of you are making them much smarter. Every brand today has gotten increasingly more sophisticated if they thought about what their digital transformation strategy is. They understand the value of attribution. And they understand how critical it is to have teams, tools, and technologies to ensure that. That has really, really become an increasing theme with CMOs and marketers out there. And you have to remember, for some of your larger brands, the CMOs have teams of data scientists and other people now, because they know how important it is to truly be data-driven. And the only way to be data-driven is to have the right talent on board, the right tools, and the right technology. So this is a crucial part of the equation as you think about it. Now, attribution. All of you know what attribution is. Now, attribution challenges. And I love when someone makes a slide and I have my own code up there. I keep forgetting to delete it. But fewer than 43% of organizations say they are capable of customer insights and analytics. Fewer than 39% claim capabilities in campaign measurement and attribution. Why do you think that is? I'm always baffled by that quote. And I've asked different people, why do you think that is, given how much money is being spent in the media space? Everyone understands the importance of being able to showcase ROI. Why are so few people able to come up with measurement plans? Many organizations have lots and lots of data. They just don't know where it is. It comes from different sources. It's in different silos. And how many of you, I mean, I've worked in organizations where there are people who hold the data like it's their personal money. And they don't share it. They don't care how helpful it will be to the company. They're hanging on to their data because they don't know what that other group is going to do with their data. That's a chief challenge. That's not a technology challenge. It's a people challenge. It's an organizational challenge. So when you think about the democratization of data and how do you make attribution and incrementality work in your organizations, step number one, you have to get everyone to commit to understanding what democratization of data is about and how it benefits the entire organization. You cannot understand and have a 360 view of your customer if the entire organization's not a part of that. One silo is not going to cut it. You're either going to be on the team or you're off the team because it won't work. And that's really key because often when it comes to making these measurement plans, there's this one person in marketing who does search. Then there's another person who does brand. Someone does video. Someone does social. Well, if they're not all working together and understanding how all of these channels are contributing to that consumer experience, that brand experience, driving brand awareness, it is impossible to have a really good measurement plan. You're going to miss too many things, and you're not ultimately going to really understand the effectiveness of what you're doing. That's really core and that's key. And that's a lot of what the work that Deloitte does with organizations is step one, let's get everyone on the same page about this. Because each group has a different understanding and has a different orientation to the data. So it's important that you sort of set the context and build that foundation up front. Now, incrementality. You've probably read, there's like quite a number of articles on incrementality of late. And I think probably one of the brands that's doing the best job with incrementality is Netflix. And they've spoken about it at length in terms of, they really understand that, you know, for many people, Netflix is almost a, I already have it, must have, all my friends have it. I don't want to be left out of the conversation on what happened on Stranger Things, so I'm getting Netflix. There isn't as much of a drive to persuade people on the value of it as it is, oh, I'm already going to get it. But there's this edge of people who are like, I may need some additional enticements to make this work. Because do I really want to spend 20 extra bucks per month on television programming-ish, video content-ish, whatever we want to call it today, even though it's a wonderful. And what they've done is really, really successful in terms of how it's driving their overall subscriber base growth and ultimately driving their profitability. I mean, I'm sure if you're, you know, 10 years ago, who would have ever thought that a Netflix would be the programming you would talk about the most? Those are the shows you watch. I mean, the idea of binge watching, that is very new. Think about it. Before television shows came on, certain day, certain time, certain channel, if you didn't watch it then, you didn't see it. Then came the TiVos of the world, and you could record it, and then came on demand. But now, I can just wait till all the episodes are up, sit back on a Sunday afternoon in the rain of Seattle, and watch them all, boom, next, next, next. That has changed consumer behavior. It's no longer, you know, the idea that I have to wait for anything. It's really instantaneous gratification. But what Netflix has done, which I think is really awesome, is understand that whole paradigm of incrementality, similar to the way the folks over at Lending Club. And I think for any marketer today, you really have to, one, have a really clear measurement plan in order to really make incrementality work for you. This is not something that you do the first shot out of the gate. You're pretty far along. You understand your customer. You've got that measurement plan in place. You understand the technology at your disposal. You understand the tools. But most importantly, you have a really holistic view of the data you have in house. That's the way it works best. Now, we talked a little bit about how incrementality works and what that lift looks like. It's important to understand that how you think about acquiring those customers and how you really think about driving that long-term value of the customer is really critical in the incrementality equation. Because what incrementality has more success at is improving the long-term value of that customer. Because this is a customer that you didn't win easily. There was that little extra tweak that you engaged in, but it often yields 2x value for the brand. And that's really key. But once again, the sophistication, the thought, and the strategy of the brand to employ it are pivotal in order to really reap those benefits. Now, how many of you, because I heard this mentioned earlier, the cloud. How many of you using GCP or some other cloud that shall remain nameless? GCP? I think you were GCP earlier. Oh, other nameless clouds, yeah, there are those other nameless clouds. What's interesting about the cloud, and I think when you think about topics of attribution and incrementality is, what does the cloud really do for you? It's all about speed. Speed to action. You're able to ingest all of this amazing data and get back great insights, ultimately answers that can do what? Drive profitability. And when you think about the cycle of cloud marketing, I always say to someone, I always love this because it really is a cycle. But there's a couple of things that few people ever talk about in this equation. Data integrity, or as I like to call it, dirty data. Dirty data will be the fault of any brand or company. If you have dirty data, guess what? This doesn't work. It just doesn't work. The data that you collect, you really have to understand your data integrity, because ultimately that's going to fuel this entire cycle. So it's like if you put bad gas in a car, it's going to sputter. That's what will happen to this. But if you really understand your technology stack, you understand where your data lives, you've ensured the integrity of that data, this thing hums like amazingly well, because it gives you that speed to analysis. You're able to derive insights that you can really activate against. And that's the point. Everyone has tons and tons of data, but they don't know what data is really important. They don't really understand how to activate against the data. And often, most people in organizations, not the data scientists, not the people on the marketing team, but the chief decision makers in the organization, have no clue as to what to do with all the data. So they need people like you in the room who can distill for them, what are the metrics that matter to us? How do you put it into this wonderful engine that we've paid a fair amount of money for, get the right insights out of, and activate so we can drive our profitability in the organization? That's how I see the role of all of you in this room, helping to really craft those measurement plans and those stories that allow those decision makers ultimately to be led in the right direction. That's your value. And your value is really increasing in the marketplace, because every time we talk to CMOs, they're always like, do you know some good data people? We're looking for some good data people. If you run across them, please let us know. Because that is the key to the future success of all of these brands. When I said 40% of the companies you know will be out of business 10 years from now, that's why. That's really why. They haven't embraced this, and they really need to. The cloud is truly helping to transform what's happening in data-driven marketing. If you're not embracing the cloud right now, you're also going to miss. The same way the people who missed on going online, the same people who missed with social, the same people who miss with technology, if you're not employing the cloud to help you with this data analysis, you're going to miss. And you will be on the wrong side of history. This is such a pivotal point in how we think about marketing that it is critical that you really understand how to leverage the cloud to get that speed to insight. And most importantly, speed to action. Action is what it is all about. You've got to have measurable and demonstrable results. Now, luckily, I had the benefit of having my wonderful Google colleague, Nami Cho, present these lovely case studies. But unfortunately, she couldn't come out of New York, and she said to me, well, I'll let you go ahead and do it, but I'm not gonna tell you who the brands are, because then I'd have to kill you. But I'll give you a little bit of insight on what organizations have done and sort of level set for you what's been the most helpful. This is a big box retailer. You'll never know the name. And this challenge was really all about how could they accelerate personalization in order to build baskets and drive retention for their high-value users. So, of course, this is an incrementality story. They've already got users, but they want those high-value users to buy even more and more and more. What was the biggest problem here? Once again, silos of data. Silos of data within the organization. So the whole exercise was about connecting the right people within that organization, helping them understand how to collect their data. GA360, big query exports. It was about how to analyze it, predictive lifetime value scores in a cloud data lab. This was actually extremely cutting edge for that organization, and they were very, very fortunate to have great help and support from Google. But at the end of the day, activation won the one case in terms of how they were able to import those long-term value scores into GA360 using data import and ultimately solve the riddle of how to drive those long-term value customers even more so that they're spending more, they're driving more profitability for the company, reorganize those carts, ultimately pull together those silos of data. And this was hugely successful. As you can imagine, what are we coming up to? Holiday season. What is the thing? This is going to be their model for how they're looking at the holiday season. Because as you know, fierce competition for consumers. Holiday season, everyone's looking to make those registers sing because this is how most brands are going to close the year. It is going to be incredibly important for brands to understand incrementality right now. More than ever, they have to really understand incrementality. So that was a really great case. And once again, the undercurrent of this was about digital transformation. Big box retailers are very much under attack. People aren't going to the malls like they used to. They're just sitting at home or on their phone or wherever shopping. So it's very, very important for big box retailers to get ahead of this, to understand what can they do to compete. How can they keep the attention of that consumer, build the appropriate marketing mixes so that they can drive the value that they need so that they can stay in business. So this was a really, really great case study, and one I definitely encourage you, if you get a chance to run into NAMI, that she can share a little bit more with you about this. But this is what the holiday season is going to be all about. And it's going to be even more critical this year, as I promise you, my neighbor here in Seattle, Amazon's got a whole bunch of stuff planned, and they're gonna start firing really quickly. So for any retailer out there, you better be ready. All right, the next case study. This was a global beauty brand. Once again, I will not tell you who because I don't know. But this brand, it was all about, they wanted to give decision makers across the data portfolio, access to data. And what's great about this particular case study is it speaks to the human element of digital transformation and attribution and incrementality. Executives at many of these companies don't come from a background of being data-driven. That's not what they know. They understand marketing. They understand brands. They understand creativity. But data? Not so much so. So this was really all about how do we present that kind of data to high-level senior executives in a way that they're going to understand it and grasp it and be able to make those key business decisions that they need to make for their company and their brand. And this really was an exercise in about building dashboards and most importantly, having teams of people who understand how to pull out those, once again, metrics that really matter, the MTM. Because ultimately, for many of these executives, they have lots of decisions on their plate. They have decisions over hiring, firing, financial decisions, a multitude of other things on their plate that actually rank much higher in priority. But they said, hey, we need to really understand where our business is going and understand what the data is telling us. But most importantly, we need to be able to see it and understand it in a way that's truly digestible for the level that we're at. you know, you have to be able to bridge those gaps and be able to embrace them and speak in a language that they can understand, and vice versa. I do a lot of work to understand the other side of the equation. So I understand what the algorithms are. I understand what the data transfer tags are. You go through understanding, taking those BigQuery classes and your cloud classes, because there's definitely a lot of education and learning that we have to do on the flip side of the house. But that human element and that human component is critical when you think about these topics, particularly attribution and incrementality. Where all that data sits, most people have just no idea. So if you're not building those bridges with the individuals and the people, you're ultimately not going to be successful in driving through this type of analysis and this type of structure in the organization. Now, in closing, now that I've bored you all to death, the competition for consumers is fierce. We're coming into the holiday season. It's even more fierce. Many, many brands, many retailers, even your time-honored tech companies like Cisco, trying to figure it out. Consumers have changed. Audiences have changed. Their expectations have changed. And it's really, really important for everyone to understand where they sit in these equations, whether it's their overall ecosystem in comparison to other competitors, or just where do they sit in terms of having a handle on their own technology, their own tools, and the talent that they have within their organizations. How do they recruit the right people? Who are the right people? Where do I find a data scientist? I mean, those are really, really topical challenges now that all CMOs are facing. And it has become literally at a fever pitch in conversations. And Deloitte spends lots of time with the top CMOs from around the world. And this is a hot topic for them because they understand what's at stake. Once again, 40% of the brands you know today will be out of business in 10 years. That's happening. That's real. The role of the CMO, the longevity of a CMO at an organization has gotten shorter and shorter and shorter. Because if they're not able to really embrace digital transformation, embrace those technologies, understand those tools, build teams of the right people, guess what? They're not driving profitability for their companies. And guess what happens? The board votes them out. We see CMOs flip jobs on average every 24 months because they can't keep up. They don't have the right teams. That's critical. They're, you know, and think about brands who were not digital first brands. There's so many. I know there were a lot of people in this room who are coming from companies that are straight digital. Like, you don't know anything else. I'm talking about the big brands, like the Unilevers, the P&Gs of the world, who were not straight digital. They've had a lot of transformation to undergo. That transformation and those people management issues are tough. The technology's easy. The people, not so much so. But for a CMO, priority number one, I have to get a handle on that. I have to really understand, how do I leverage the data that I have? Where is the data? Do I own the data? Is it clean data or is it dirty data? Who can help me with the data? Do I have a measurement plan? Am I using the cloud? Which cloud should I be using? All of those conversations are happening in real time. And it's important that as you think about what you do as brands, as other, you know, agencies, as you talk to different people, take a look at the overall picture. Because ultimately, it's not just solving for one piece of the pie, it's really understanding the entire puzzle that's at stake. Obviously, the growing landscape on ad tech and martech is very interesting. Because you'll hear, every day I hear about new companies I've never heard of before popping up. There's so many. And I often say to people, just as many start as many stop. You really have to choose someone that you can trust, who's ahead of the curve when it comes to innovation, and most importantly, someone who has a commitment to your business. Because once again, 40% of businesses will be out in 10 years. So if you're not working with a technology provider that's really solid, that really, really is committed to your success as a company, as a brand, it's probably not such a good idea. And the reality is, there's so many technology options out there today, but you really have to have a clear perspective on what are your goals? What's the mission of your company, your brand? How are you thinking about making your business more future-proof? Because the competitors are building and building and building. Consumer expectation has risen at an increasingly higher volume. And it's global. It's not just in the US. So you've got to be thinking about all of those factors. So this perfect storm of market disruption, it's real. And in order to get ahead of it, you have to be thinking about things like, where do we sit from a measurement perspective? How are we thinking about attribution and incrementality? But it all starts with making sure that you have a really good view on what? Your customer. It all starts with understanding that and then building back out from it with the right partners, the right talent, the right tools, and the right technology. Well, that's it for me.